From Tally to Cali,
it's time to wake up.
Wake up. Wake up. Wake up.
Warchant.com is your ultimate Seminole sports source.
And this is Wake Up Warchant, presented by Corner Pocket Bar and Grill.
One ball, Corner Pocket.
Now here's Warchant.com's ass on Hunch of Andy.
And Corey Clark.
Wake up! What is up, everybody? It is Wake Up Warchant, presented by Corner Pocket Bar and Grill. Coming up on today's show, Renegade Express. Lots of good questions, Corey. Newcomers, returners, and a world where Florida State just hangs 650 yards every single Saturday and the quarterback never gets touched. Follow us, won't you? Wake Up Warchant, presented by the Corner Pocket Bar and Grill in Tallahassee, Florida, cptallybar.com. That is the website. You can always hit that QR code on your screen. We'll take you right to that website without having to do all that pesky typing. Lunch special today, hand-breaded chicken fingers. Go get you some. Social calendar looking very robust as well over at the Corner Pocket Bar and Grill. Go check it out this weekend. Or shoot, if you can't make it this weekend, go sometime next week. Can't do next week, week after that. Just go. You'll love it. I promise. Corner Pocket Bar and Grill, 2475 Appalachia Parkway. Only a few days left to hop on the special. $10 American, 4 months full premium access to warchant.com. No promo code needed. Just go to warchant.com. It's right there on the front page. If you're not a member, you'll see it. It's in like neon green. You cannot miss it. Join us. It'll be fun. Thumbs up, 5-star rating and review, and yeah, subscribe to the YouTube channel as well. Corey Clark, what is up, man?
What's up, buddy? How you doing? You doing all right?
Good. A little pep in the step. A little pep in the step. Feeling good. Feeling good. How you feeling, man? You look solid on Thursday, man, at baseball availability. Did you just get back from the gym, or are you on your way to the gym?
I was just getting back. I was I just left the gym and got there. Not even a hard workout for my standards these days, Aslan. But, hey, I appreciate the shout-out, buddy.
Right on.
I appreciate the shout-out. Felt good. Always feels good when you're leaving the gym.
All right, let's get to the mailbag. It's pretty much it's all – no, there was one basketball question, random_John.
Okay.
Baseball-wise, though, real quick, so if you can make it out Friday today over at Hauser, 6 o'clock pit. Beforehand, though, get there beforehand, like 30 minutes early. Jameis Winston, Jalen Ramsey, Cam Akers, lots of...
Derwin, right?
Yeah.
Derwin?
Yeah. I think so, yeah. Lots of luminaries of yesteryear, yesterweek, will be at Dick Houser Stadium as part of like this junior day bonanza to recruit the best and the brightest of the Florida State football program. So they're bringing some of these big-time alums back. And then Saturday, Buster Posey, there will be a celebration retiring his number. Alongside J.D. Drew and some other greats, Mike Martin, Dick Houser. So it'll be a fun weekend. But baseball-wise, though, so I don't know. You know more about baseball than I do. You know about most everything more than I do. I don't know. I'd rather have Wyatt Crowell for 3 innings on Friday and Saturday or Saturday and Sunday than have him for 6 innings on Friday. He will start this weekend against Pitt. Thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't playing out like you wanted it to play out, right? Like, if they were going to use him the way I thought they were going to use him, then it would have made sense to keep him in that role. But if he's only going to pitch once a weekend anyway, which was what was happening, why not let him start and go 6 or 7? And hopefully by that point, maybe you have an 8-1, 8-2 lead, and you can piece it together in the bullpen to get you a win. Look, he's going to pitch 6 innings. If he's going to pitch 6 innings in a weekend, and you're not going to split it up between 2 days, then it really doesn't matter if he comes in relief on a Sunday or a Saturday, or if he just starts on a Saturday. So that's what they're doing. He's starting on Saturday, and Ballmeister and Montgomery stay Friday and Sunday.
Okay. All right. There we go. Let's get to the mailbag. Casey_Chance13. Morning, fellas. I'm stuck here working midshift, USAF. That's United States Air Force, kids. Waiting on the planes to come down. So I pulled up the spring roster. I saw 11 linebackers on there. There's no way. I need to corroborate this, Corey. I'm going to do it after I read this. I'll let you go. We all know who the starters will be, but do y'all see anyone leaving to make room? Also, do you see younger guys sneaking into the lineup like an AJ Cottrell? Thanks for the content and support the many sponsors of War Chant, everybody. So let me go here. I mean, if they really have 11 dudes, not all 11 are on scholarship. So
no.
That doesn't seem like an attrition piece of the scholarship puzzle, Corey, to me at least.
No, I wouldn't think so. I think the scholarship guys are if I can do them off the top of my head, Bethune, Deloach, Lundy, Dix, Brendan Grant, yeah. Graham, Blake Nicholson, although he's not here yet.
DeMarco Ward's here, yeah. So Deloach, Lundy, Bethune, Gant, DeMarco Ward, early enrollee freshman, Steven Dix, Omar Graham, then walk-ons, McClassen, Cottrell, Oliver, Amay.
That and safety, and I'm going to keep saying this until I guess the roster changes or I just stop saying it. Those are the two that still concern me a little bit. I think you have solid-ish players at those spots. But if anything happens, I mean, you know, right now, if you're talking to Corey Clark, and you are, you're listening to him in March of 2023, if Steven Dix is having to be put into a starter's role, you might be in trouble. I'm not trying to kill the kid, but there's a significant drop-off between, in my opinion, Lundy, Bethune, and Deloach, and everybody else. And that, you know, again, we'll see more now, you know, today the pads come on. And Grant, maybe Graham takes a step. That's allowed, right? He's a redshirt freshman. He made some flash plays last year as a true freshman. They do like him. So maybe he's a guy that can contribute. And maybe it would have been so big if Blake Nicholson could have gotten here in the spring.
Yeah.
It just would have been so big for his development and also the team as a whole. But maybe Nicholson can somehow be one of those kids that just it clicks early, and he can play fast and free even as a true freshman with 20 practices under his belt. I doubt that's happening, but maybe by the middle of the season he can earn some run. But, I as far as the question about attrition, I don't – you know,
I'll
those
– amend it, Corey. I don't know. It'd be hard to see
Dix?
Them. Yeah, but it'd be hard to see them push him out because he's coming off a season-ending injury. He's obviously rehabbed the best that he could.
Well, what did we say? What are there, 8 scholarship linebackers?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Deloach, so Lundy, Bethune, Gant, Ward, Dix, Graham.
And Nicholson.
8. Well, that's 7 right now. But yeah,
right, Nicholson. But 8 in the spring. That, I mean, 8 when you get to the fall. That's not a lot.
But they play 4-2-5, though, you know.
Well, right, but I mean, I don't know if you, like you're pointing out, like, you know, there might be Dix could be a serviceable role player, and he is a guy that maybe can play you 20 snaps in certain situations against certain offenses. He's not a guy that you're going to love in coverage, probably, but against certain offenses, maybe he makes sense, but he's also played a lot, or he's been around the program a lot. I just don't know that's a guy that that attrition helps your team. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't. There's other spots where you're going to lose some guys. I don't know that linebacker, to me, the depth of linebacker and safety, I think if anything, you're adding to that position group, not taking away from it.
Next up, Island Chief. Wake up. Man, a duplicate question last week. I'm going to blame it on Alford's Board of Trustees comments that messed up my Wake Up Board Chant listening plans. Moving on, though. Here's my question. Last year, wideouts. Big step forward as a group. Do they have another step like that in them? Can Johnny Wilson become All-American?
The second question, yes, he can. I don't know that he will. I'm not predicting he will. But you think about some of the drops he had. He finished with 900 yards receiving. He could have had, I don't know, 1,150. Yeah, 1,200. I mean, he dropped some. If he makes almost all of the catches. Because he makes the spectacular ones, and he can make he made plenty of routine ones too, but there were also plenty of almost spectacular ones he didn't grab and plenty of routine ones that he dropped. If those can be eliminated by 80%, then I think you're looking at All-American candidate because he's unguardable. He's just unguardable. What do you do with him? He made on Wednesday a couple other – it's almost like with him, you don't even judge the DBs.
Yeah.
You know, if Portier or Williamson makes a catch leaping over you, you're like, come on, man, you got to fight harder. If Johnny Wilson makes a catch over you, you're like, well, what are you going to do?
Right.
Good try. Get him next time.
Well said. As a group, though, I mean, I think Darion Williamson, there's a lot of room between he and his ceiling. So
yep.
I could see him obviously become, and they really like him a lot, man. They run him out there quite often. Obviously, Winston Wright's a guy that we didn't see at all last year. He now becomes part of your probably main rotation of guys. Yeah, they could be pretty formidable. Big step, why not? I mean, you got nothing. You got nothing out of Winston Wright. Now you're hoping you're going to get 13 weeks out of him, 12 games regular season, and then Darion Williamson, you know, only was really scratching the surface until week 4, and then you lost him. So I certainly could see that. And we'll see how these freshmen look. I mean, Hakeem and Vandravis Jacobs out there as well. They'll help. So, yeah, it's pretty crazy to think about. The running game is going to be the running game. It's just what he does. Everywhere he's been, Norvell has figured this thing out. Now Alex Atkins got this offensive line to a really strong point. So, really good offensive, really good receiving group.
Yeah, and I think you lost Pokey and you lost Malik McClain. Well, I think Darian Williamson can more than make up for Malik McClain. I think Darian Williamson is a guy that is about to take off. This is the year. He stands out a lot in practice. That body type and the way he moves is pretty impressive. And you could tell in the bowl game how much they think about him. Because when he was finally healthy, they ran a lot of stuff for him. They wanted him involved. I think he's a guy that it's basically like what he played two games last year that mattered. Like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I think he played two games, and Winston Wright played zero games. So those are like free agent acquisitions, but good players. So, yeah. And then you just got to imagine that guys like Portier, Johnny Wilson, Micah Pittman, they all get better. And if they just get incrementally better, and then these two guys can at least replace and probably outproduce what Malik McClain and Pokey Wilson gave you, then, yeah, you look like you're going to have a better wideout group. I don't know if it'll take the same sizable leap that it took, but from 2021 when it was awful to 2022 when it was actually pretty good, but it should take another jump. I just don't know if it'll be like a, you know, the Bob Beamon jump it took last year.
Strong. 63 reps out of Darion over four games. Duquesne, Louisville, Boston College, Oklahoma.
Yeah.
So, man, he graded out at 93.2 against Boston College.
Strong. He was awesome, man.
Yeah.
I there is a chance, right, that he's like the next big thing here. I truly believe that. I haven't seen enough of it, and we'll see. Again, pads are on starting today, and it's his spring. He needs to shine this spring. They know what Johnny can do. Johnny's got to get better too, but Darian Williamson needs to stake his claim this spring to what he's going to be on this football team, and I think he will. It's not normal the way he moves. In and out of breaks at that size. He could be a real difference maker.
Kurt OFD78, one of those firefighter guys that we were hanging out with in Orlando.
Yep.
Wake up, fellas. With the number of tight ends we will have on this team, I wondered about a possible new offensive wrinkle for Coach Norvell and Atkins. We come out of a timeout situation, the team all gathered up on the sideline, and then we break the huddle with the following skill players. I'm going to mark this down. I'm going to add some like chimes. Like some fantasy kind of sounds.
Okay.
Trey Benson, Jordan Travis backfield. Markeeson Douglas lined up next to a tackle on one side. Kyle Morlock, Jarrell Powers, Jaheim Bell all spread out at traditional wide receiver spots. This personnel group gives us numerous options depending upon alignment. Travis can keep. He can hand it to Benson. He can throw it to any of these five eligible receivers on the field. In a run play, the tight ends provide a formidable blocking group, though give up the ability to stretch the field. In a pass play, we've got five options that are physical mismatches with most, if not all, of the back seven of a defense. Near the goal line, this grouping could present numerous problems if they are bunched in tightly. Heck, we could even run a jet sweep with Bell between the 20s. What say you?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, why not? I don't know that it'll be that many tight ends on the field in certain situations, but Jaheim Bell will be a very big part of whatever they're doing in any offense, whether it's goal line, third and 12. I mean, he's going to be a big part of it. And I think there will be some three tight end sets where it's not traditional three tight ends where they're all, it's goal line and you're just going to run it up the middle. They've got some unique body types and some unique ability in that room. And again, they love Jarrell Powers. Jarrell Powers looks good out there, man, just the way he runs. He's certainly behind the other guys, but the way he moves at that size, again, that's a guy that could be something. That room has upgraded significantly. And, yes, they did not bring them here to not play a lot. I just wonder, you could take advantage of certain defenses, I'm sure, and catch them off guard. Like, look, man, Jaheim Bell, you could say you can't stretch a defense. I think you can with him. You can't with Morlock. Morlock's not going to run by a cornerback, but Morlock will run by a linebacker. And I think Jaheim Bell can run with cornerbacks. And Markeeson can just post him up 12 yards downfield because nobody's getting around that body. So you got some options with those dudes.
I don't know if I've ever heard of 14 personnel, but why not?
Yeah, man, try it out, Mike. Yeah. What else do you? What? Yeah, do it. What do you have all those tight ends in the room for if you're not going to play them all at once?
Nolboy02, hey, Azon and Corey, wake up. I watched a video where Buster Posey was mentioned as one of the best college baseball players of all time. But I asked my father, he believed J.D. Drew was better. So, who was the better college baseball player, Buster Posey, J.D. Drew?
It's a good question. It's a fair question. Funnily enough, I was just talking about that recently with someone, and it's not close. I love Buster Posey. Mm-hmm. He had the best career of anyone, any Florida State player in the major leagues by far. He's going to be a Hall of Famer. He needs to be in Cooperstown in 4 years. J.D. Drew was the better college baseball player because I think J.D. Drew is the best college baseball player that ever lived. It is ridiculous what that guy did. Absolutely ridiculous. He dwarfed, well, it's hard to say he dwarfed Buster's numbers, but he basically did in his last year, his junior year. He had 30 home runs, 30 stolen bases. He drove in over 100 and scored 100. Think about that production in this 55 or 60 game season. It's absurd. And he played center field and could run stuff down. It's just that combination of size and power and skill in those numbers, that production is just I don't think it'll ever be matched. And Buster was awesome. Buster was awesome for 1 year. JD was really awesome for 2.5 to 3. And JD was Superman his junior year. Like, his numbers, even as good as Buster's were as a junior, JD's were better. And, yeah, so it's JD, but you could certainly make the argument that Buster clearly was the better overall baseball player because of what he did at the highest level.
Yeah, man, you know, I got to Florida State after JD Drew had left, but he was still spoken about with such reverence. I mean, he was like Paul Bunyan.
Yeah.
So I don't know how much of that was coming off the – sort of the heels of that magical run they had where they were seemingly going to Omaha every single year. You know, meanwhile, Buster was kind of scratching and clawing to make it out there. And the program wasn't where it was in the 90s. How much of it's a technology, though, Corey? I'm trying to pull up some information here because I know Buster was still in that window, I think, with the BB Core bat or whatever they called it. But I feel like the bats that J.D. Drew had in the 90s were still even on a different level than what, you know, Buster was swinging. So it's kind of – it's not quite – apples to oranges, but it's a little bit of a hedge kind of in JD's favor, I think, with the way the bats and the balls were then. No?
Oh, sure. I just, more than anything, it's even if you say they were even as hitters, what JD did on the bases, the fact that he scored 100 runs and would take second on a bloop single, or he would score from first on a double to the wall, like, those are the things that he did that Buster just couldn't do because athletically he wasn't J.D. Drew. So that just his combination of the power, the batting average, and the speed is what made him so unique. Like, he was the when you read those prospect reviews for the big time players in his class, he was the fastest prospect. Like, not just always fast for a guy that hits home runs. No, he was major league elite speed fast. He could really, really run. But
5-tool guy, right?
Yes, correct. And it never quite worked out with him in major leagues. He had a nice career. He certainly wasn't like a bust, but he was not, you know, Buster Posey. And also, I think JD also had more moments in Omaha. Like you mentioned, his freshman year, he had a walk-off home run in Omaha, which you can't beat that. They still showed that at Hauser before the game. Opposite field walk-off. And then in the game they ended up losing to Southern Cal in an elimination game, he hit 3 home runs in that game. So he I think he used to have the record for most home runs in Omaha. So it was what he did on the biggest stage, too. And unfortunately, Buster only got there once. And because it's Florida State, they went 0-2. But he was Buster that last year. And they had a lot of elimination games. They lost to Bucknell somehow in the first round, or the first game of the regional, and then had to win 4 or 5 in a row to get out of that regional, and Buster was incredible. And then they lost to Wichita State in the first game of the Super Regional, and Buster was incredible in game 2 and 3 to get them out of that. So, yeah, man, you're talking literally about 2 of the 5 or 6 best players that have ever played college baseball. I think JD is a tick above.
Ira Brofell.
Okay.
Is this the year the Tribal Council stops asking about Ira Henry?
Yes.
I didn't realize that was a thing.
I didn't either, but it's got to stop now. I would say Deshaun Platt was maybe ended 6 or 7 years ago. Yeah. So now, and we still got the Destin Hill.
We actually have a question about him in the mailbag.
Saga, I was going to say that's taken over for all of those other, chupacabra type players. It's now all been funneled into Destin Hill.
Primetime 92, wake up. Corey, at what point in your fitness journey does Mike Norvell realize he is not the best-looking guy in the room anymore?
I think that probably happened 3 months ago, Aslan, would you say?
Accurate.
No, that's not true. If you asked Stephanie to choose right now, she would. The question wouldn't even be done getting out of your mouth, and she would say Mike Norvell. So I think he's just got some stuff that genetics I just can't compete with. But I would say
– too, maybe.
Well, yes, indeed. I will say that I think I'm in as good a shape as he is now, which is cool. But I wanted to give him a shout-out. So now he doesn't race Robert Cooper anymore at the start of every practice. You know, for the people that don't know, they'll all huddle up in the IPF, the whole team, after they do their stretches at around, I don't know, the 10-yard line. And then last year, Robert Cooper would take off trying to sprint to the other end of the end zone, and Mike Norvell would sprint in a race to beat him. And Norvell always beat him until the one day he pulled his hamstring. But he always beat Cooper because Cooper's 340 pounds and Norvell's, I don't know, 180. But I saw Norvell race the entire defensive line on Wednesday, and my man looks like he's put on some speed. He's added some speed. I was about to say put on some weight. No, man, he looked faster than he's ever looked since he's been doing this stuff at Florida State.
Well, maybe
it's like he found an extra gear.
Monday he got taken to the cleaners, man, I think.
Oh, did he really?
Yeah, Monday he lost. So
I didn't see. Well, look, now he lost to Patrick Payton on Wednesday too.
Okay.
But it's Patrick Payton. I mean, at some point I'm going to need my 235-pound defensive end to beat his 40-year-old coach in a race. Like, okay. I'm not worried about that. The way Norvell was running with those guys, though, and they're not a lot of Robert Coopers in that group anymore. It was really impressive. The guy's in really good shape, it would appear. Not Corey Clark's shape, but then again, who is? Am I right, Aslan?
Right.
By the way, I've really screwed up my heel.
Yeah.
I've done something to my heel before we started recording. I can't run anymore right now. I'm doing power walking, which, I mean, I don't feel great about it. I'll be honest, on a treadmill power walking, I'm not 100% happy with that.
Hit the bike.
And then, yeah, I might do it, or I might just stick with the rower instead of doing that at all. But right before we started recording, I hit my heel on the chair I'm in, and it really shot through me. Like, it's painful. It's not painful when I'm walking on it. It is painful when I run. But when I walk, I was fine, I felt. And then that was the worst pain of all, is when I hit the back of my heel. So I'm worried it could be an Achilles. It could be plantar fasciitis. I'm not fired up about getting it checked out, because I know that's what's going to end my fitness journey is an injury. And I'm not excited about it.
I was about to say, man, we can't have all these aesthetics hitting on all cylinders and then the health not be there along with it. So let's prehab, rehab, all that sort of stuff. Primetime 92 trying to get me to wade into some troubled waters here. Aslan, as a single guy in the pod, I'm not going to answer this question. I'm just going to read it because I love you, Primetime 92. I was reading how women in their 20s and 30s are not dating or in relationships at much higher percentages than even 10 or 20 years ago. Do you think with the rise of social media, likes, attention, that more women value that status and holding out for a dream man more than just dating normal guys? Your thoughts? Hope you're not implying that I'm a normal guy. I'm elite.
He's clearly not. You are elite. Yeah.
Now things are changing, man. The women have jobs and stuff, man. They don't need men anymore.
What's the next question?
We'll get into this at some other point, Primetime. It's a good question.
I'd love it. I'd love to have an hour-long conversation on how...
No, it's great. I mean, listen, women are super ambitious, and, you know, being in relationships, starting families kind of throws a wrench into those plans more so than it does for a man, and traveling. I mean, the only social media thing I will say is I do think there is a sort of Instagram wanderlust sort of, fantasy out there about traveling all over the place and how that should take precedence and... Over traditional sort of tracks or whatever. So, but otherwise, no, I don't think the social media is really that much part of this whole equation. I think it's more of like just professional wise. There's more avenues for women to be successful than trying to find a man, you know, which is great. I'm not complaining at all. I hope you didn't think I wasn't complaining, everybody. International Women's Day. Happy belated, y'all. I'll Venmo you $50. Give me your names. Noles dad for life. Wake up, fellas. I know it's hard right now to take too much away as we're only just in the first week of spring football. With that being said, which position group will be our strength? Which will be our weakness? Give me both offensive and defense. Also, who are the most vocal newcomers? Last year it was Verse. Who is it this year?
Well, that's Byers.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jeremiah Byers is the most vocal that we can tell so far. Mm. We'll get to see more. Again, we're pretty far away from the action. Like, we get to see it, but we don't get to hear a lot. But Byers is so loud you can hear him. I would...
Your actions speak so loud, I can't hear your words. Mm. We're not there yet.
You know what? I told that to Brady about a year ago. I tell you what, the more I get away from Jimbo Fisher, the more I'm like, you know what? I see what you were doing, Jimbo. I see what you were doing. All this applies, even now. I mean, right now, Brady's a show dog. He's not a hunting dog, and I'm trying to make him a hunting dog. There's not a weak group on the offense.
Correct.
There isn't one. I almost wouldn't say there's a strength either. They are all very, very strong. I don't know how you would differentiate between tight ends and offensive line, or running backs and tight ends, or running backs and receivers. They're all very strong.
Think about the drop off from that starter to that's what I almost say, like the offensive line.
That's what I'm saying, but there isn't one.
Well, right? I mean, right. From Jordan to Tate, that's going to be, you'll feel that. But I think if Jeremiah Byers goes down and Bless Harris slides in, actually, I don't know. Jeremiah Byers is probably going to be really good, so he probably would feel that as well. But they're just, it's hard to judge one guy that's on the field versus a five-guy unit. I know they're individual pieces.
Right.
But maybe it's through the prism that the offensive line was so just not strong for so long. The options were limited, and the options that you did have didn't seem to be all that capable. And now you have all these capable guys on your front line, and then behind them seem to be guys that are not going to let you down. They're not going to let go of the rope, if you will. So that to me is just, that's incredible. So I have to celebrate that whenever we have the opportunity.
But what's cool about all of them, I mean, quarterback's its own unique position. Like you can certainly, you could make the argument that it is the biggest strength of the team because of who's the starter. But all those other positions, what's so cool about them is the depth and the versatility of the depth. I would say maybe running back is the least proven because you've got a really good one in Benson. You know what Toafili can do. But, you know, Rodney Hill hasn't really proven anything yet. Neither has Keziah Holmes. But you know those guys are talented. Rodney Hill's going to be very good, I think. So, and then wide receiver, same thing. You've got some guys that have proven a lot, some guys that haven't proven much at all. But the versatility of the experience, the versatility of the body sizes, the body frames, the types of athletes they are, the fact that you probably go, you might have a rotation of 7 or 8, at wide receiver, like competent, good players. The fact that you have at least 3 tight ends, probably 4 or 5. Again, that's just the depth of it right now, injuries aside, because there haven't been any really. That's what's so unique about this offense. There is not a weak point. I don't know what you – if we want to call offensive line its own position and not break it down to center, tackle, guard, I don't see a weakness in this on the offense. On defense, it's safety and linebacker.
Yes. Strength, what do you think the strength is?
D-line.
Interior?
Well, if we want to make it, yes, interior if we want to get specific. But overall, again, that versatility, that group, you have a first-round pick off one edge. You have a dude that looks like Jared Verse on the other edge, just long and angular and Edmund. McClendon's a solid player. Peyton might be a dude, like a real dude. So you've got all that. You've got all that, and that's just the defensive end. And then like we talked about yesterday, Daryl Jackson looks unlike any guy they've had at tackle here in a long time, and he's probably not going to start. Or he's going to split reps with Braden Fisk and Fabian Lovett and Josh Farmer and those guys. So, man, I just that defensive line, if it can stay healthy, when you're running 8 or 9 deep, like legitimately 8 or 9 deep, guys that can play and have played, that's really exciting.
It's going to be a long day for your guys. We got practice later on this evening, but I'll be all right. Corey's going to be all right because we got Vitamin Energy on our sides. VitaminEnergy.com, promo code WARCHANT, BOGO. Add an item to your cart. Add another item for absolutely free, equal lesser value. Can't beat it. VitaminEnergy.com. I'll be fine because we got natural caffeine, 260 milligrams of it in one shot. I'll only take about half of it because that's all I need to go through the entire day. And I'm going to have a max effort lower leg day, Corey. Front goblet squats. Then we're going to hit the sled. Then we're going to do the leg press, little hack squat. Probably even going to mix in some deads. And I'm going to make it out to practice. And you won't even notice that I'm totally fatigued because I'll have vitamin energy. We're going to go with the Immune Plus because the Tango Orange is so good. Not only do we have that natural caffeine, also some green tea extract as well. And vitamins B12 and B2 to boost my immune system. Can't wait to see you there later today. I'm going to be all perky, though. So be ready, Corey. That's how I roll now.
You're always perky. You're always perky. Especially now that we Vitamin Energy's come on board.
VitaminEnergy.com. Promo code, again, Warchant, B-O-G-O. They're Noles. Support them. They're helping you out with that awesome promo code. VitaminEnergy.com. Shake it and take it. Moving on. NYC Noel. What's up, fellas? Wake up! It's been a minute. Question for you. Do you see any scenario benefiting Florida State to slow play joining a conference? Could a slow play from us leading to the Big Ten SEC bidding war for our membership? If so, what is it? Or do we jump at the first offer on the table? Thanks, gentlemen. Drink DeLuna. Click War Chant on the right. Yeah, that's right, on the podcast version. Let's bundle that as well, I guess, with Bishop 1617. He was asking, by the way, he said he met me and Ira Pensacola last month, longtime listener, first-time question. Pensacola native, home of Seminole great Derek Brooks, class of 2005 alum. Pac-12 ACC, is that a real possibility of that merger? If it were to take place, where would this conference fall in the pecking order in relation to the Big 12? I think we'd be above the Big 12.
Yes.
Yeah, so slow playing a conference, or do we just take the first lifeboat we see out there? NYC, Noel, Bishop, 1617 conference stuff. Corey, thoughts?
Yeah, well, in with the Pac-12, I just it depends on what it looks like. But with Washington and Oregon and, you know, I guess Dion and Colorado, it would be appealing enough with all these other. Arizona State could be something with old Dilly Dilly.
Yeah. Utah's been pretty solid.
Yeah, Utah's been good. I mean, that obviously I think that's above the Big 12, but still below the two big ones. And it would be, man, imagine that travel. Come on now. We don't need that. We don't need that in our lives. I would say, I keep saying this, and it's the truth. I mean, if the Big 10 makes you an offer, you seriously consider it, but you do give the SEC a chance to counter. You have to do that because every person listening to this show, not every person, let's say 97 to 99% of them wants Florida State in the SEC. It's a like-minded conference with like-minded fans. It's all closer. It's drivable, real fan bases. You're not having to go to Minnesota. You're not having to go to West Lafayette or East Lansing. You always wonder, what's West Lansing like? You know what I mean? Like, they never even talk about West Lansing or East Lafayette.
Yeah,
it's crazy. Do they not even exist? Like, it's nuts. But
I'm from East Lake, and there isn't a West Lake. Tarpon Springs is west of the lake. So,
but it's not East Space Lake, right? It's all one word, East Lake.
No, it's like East, Lansing. It's East Space Lake. Yeah.
Oh, is Lake a city? Because Lansing is a city in Michigan.
Oh, yeah. Well, there you
go. Then there's East Lansing and West Lansing.
Maybe it's just woods. Or maybe it's the border. Maybe it's another
state. Maybe it's a lake. Yeah. Maybe the west part of Lansing is one of their lakes.
Yeah.
But with the Big Ten, Florida State fans would much prefer the Big Ten to the ACC. Clearly, they would. Again, 99% of people listening to this would take the Big Ten over the ACC right now in a heartbeat. But you really do want to be in the SEC. It's the better conference. Again, it's better fan bases. It's closer, regionalized. A lot of Florida State fans live near and go to work with Florida fans or Georgia fans or Auburn fans. Not many of them are going to are you know, friends with Michigan State fans or Northwestern fans. You're just not. It's just it makes more sense from a regional standpoint and a fandom standpoint to get to the SEC. But if they don't come calling, but the Big Ten's offering you twice as much money than the ACC is currently giving you, you would go to the Big Ten in a heartbeat. But you would, I think, give the SEC a chance to counter. Give them a chance to at least come close or get you the money that the Big Ten is offering you, because you just that's what you want. That's what you want in the long game, is to be playing Georgia, Alabama, Auburn, and LSU every year and not Purdue, Michigan, Ohio State, Michigan State. It'd be cool. Michigan and Ohio State would be cool, but I just think weather-wise, regional-wise, the way most of us grew up watching college football, we care more about the teams in the South, and it would be a lot more fun for us, I think.
I just wonder, being in this grant of rights, this whole 2036 albatross that's hanging around from your neck, like, does it make you, like, do you learn your lesson? Like, we are going to do such due diligence. We're going to take our time. We will not be forced. We will not be cornered into signing something that is not good for our long-term health and viability. Or is this such a bad albatross? Is this such a bad deal that you're in that as soon as anything from the Big Ten comes even across your, it's like, yes. Yes, I didn't look at it. Yes, we're in, like, equal distribution. Yes,
You do if you're Michael Offord and the Big Ten comes calling and says, "We have a spot for you in 2027."
I'd be like, "Hey,
right
you've got 24 hours." Like, they're not going to be like, "Yeah, you got two weeks, and then you can have all this time to back channel the SEC." I feel like they'd be like, "Hey, man, you got 24 hours yesterday."
Right, that's plenty of time to reach out to the SEC and tell them.
Okay,
and like, look, we're not BSing. They have an offer for us right now to join in 2027, to run to 2033, to be in the Big Ten, where we'll be making $85 million a year as opposed to $42 million a year. We are going to take it unless you give us a reason not to right now. And put the onus on them. Because the SEC does not want to – look, the SEC is cool with Florida State being in the ACC right now because that's not a threat to them. The Florida State and Clemson, if Clemson's a part of the deal, and Miami, going to the Big Ten – is a threat to the SEC.
How
that
though?
Makes, I mean, because like, that makes the Big Ten a viable candidate to be the best conference in the country. Imagine Florida State, Clemson, even Miami, I guess to an extent, with Big Ten money. And you're already just added USC to go along with Michigan and Ohio State and Wisconsin and Penn State. Well, now I just named eight pretty darn big important football schools.
But they still got, Alabama and Texas. And Georgia.
No, I know. In Georgia. In Auburn.
But
I'm saying that's not as big a blowout as it sounds. Like, that's Penn State, Florida State, Clemson, Ohio State, Michigan, USC. That's close to Texas, Alabama, Auburn, LSU, Georgia, and Tennessee, or whoever else you want to throw in there.
So what, like, you're going to lose arguments on Twitter about who's the best conference? Like, ESPN is still probably going, they're going to continually give all the money they have and all the showcase they have to the SEC, even if Clemson and Florida State and Miami go to the Big Ten. I mean, Fox can dress it up as much as they want. And I know you talked about Fox investing more into college football, and the high noon slot has been a big deal. But, man, it's – I don't know. Maybe I'm just so indoctrinated into the ESPN ecosystem. And I wake up on Saturday, I put on game day. I'm that guy. I don't think they're against us. I love Reese, and I love Desmond, and I love Kirk, and I love Coach Corso. Like, I grew up on game day. That brand is embedded in me. And nothing's going to change that, man. That's just the way it is. Like, they can, I don't know, they can put Jimbo on high noon when he gets fired and put him on Fox. Probably not going to watch the Fox pregame show. I saw these sort of words about the big, you know, SEC feeling threatened if Clemson and Florida State were to leave. And I'm not trying to slander our university here, man. I just don't know, like, who would ESPN lose a sleep if that happens? Like, I mean, I don't know, like, where do they start feeling losses? I mean, is it a PR hit? Do they feel that, I don't know, advertisers are going to want to go on Fox's game lineup and advertise on those games rather than ESPN. I don't know where that kind of dynamic comes into play.
It becomes a real rivalry of conferences, in the sense that, again, Florida State and Clemson with Big Ten money become, you know, very, very viable candidates to get in the playoff and win national titles repeatedly. Because they've done it without Big Ten money. So that, I think, threatens the SEC ecosystem. And the way they promote every time an SEC team pulls off an upset, oh, that's the best three-loss team in the country. Well, they lost to Tulane early. It doesn't matter. That's the best three-loss team in the country. They do that all the time. That stuff will fall more on deaf ears when there's another conference that has as many teams in the top 20 as the SEC. It has as many teams in the playoff as the SEC. It could be 5-5, man. Like, I'm just saying, there could be – right now they dominate the Big Ten when it matters in the playoffs. I don't think that happens if nearly as much when you start talking – maybe they get Washington and Oregon too. And so now you're talking about USC, Washington, Oregon, all getting this Big Ten money, being part of the AFC, and the SEC is the NFC. I think it goes back and forth. I think it becomes, instead of the SEC dominating the postseason, I legitimately think it becomes a two conference sport, but two really good conferences. Really good conference. I would love to see Florida State getting Vanderbilt money.
This is me more being like, I can't buy all the way into Clemson. Like, I get it. They've been much better than Florida State the last 10 years, but I've been on the planet for longer than 10 years, and Clemson has not been that great most of the years I've been on this planet. So, like, that's where most of this sort of comes into play with me about feeling threatened and stuff. And I get it, man. They've had a hell of a run, man. I am jealous and envious of the run that Clemson has had of late. But I also understand that this sport is so cyclical. And, I mean, I don't know, like, was there a run in the early, the late 70s, early 80s? Was that even really a run? I mean, I know they got a ring out of it. That's awesome. But otherwise, they've been pretty forgettable most of my life. So I just
– right.
I don't – us, Florida State being on the upswing, for sure. That's a huge piece of any puzzle that puts you into these markets down here in Florida. And you have so many Big Ten folks in the state of Florida, all of Ohio and Michigan. They all transplant down here. So that maybe – it makes things a little bit interesting for the conference war. So, but good points.
Well,
there,
and you look at the, and we'll get off this right here after this. But like the current landscape of the sport, the modern college football. How many current Big Ten schools have proven they can win a national championship in modern college football? Penn State, I guess.
But in
94, if you
it,
want
no.
to count that.
But
in 94, yeah. if you want to count 94, they did, and you know they have the infrastructure and the fan base. And the coach, quite frankly, where maybe they could pull it off or have a great run. No. But Ohio State, Michigan, Florida State, Clemson, Miami, USC. Well, that's seven teams right there that have proven, have won national championships in the last 30 years. That's right up there with the SEC, man.
Yeah.
You know, that's all. That's all. But so Clemson, the point being, Clemson has proven they can do it. What is the absolute ceiling of a Arkansas or an Ole Miss, or a Mississippi State, or a Northwestern, or a Purdue, or a Michigan State? I don't think it's a national championship. There aren't; those are kind of rare. Clemson is one of those teams that can, has proven it can win a national championship.
Yeah. All right, I don't want to further argue. Let's go.
All right, there you go.
Random underscore John, good
You
morning.
Just think Dabo's awesome. You think it's all about Dabo. I got you. I feel you.
Well, I was about to say, it's been one dude, and it's been a confluence of this program being in such a rut, and him taking advantage of it, to his credit. But it's been one dude and a really weird, a very non-traditional sort of role for Florida State to find themselves not being the top dog in this conference to allow them to be successful. Now Florida State's on the upswing. We'll see how if there's enough room for both of us in this 12-team. In the 12-team playoff, yes. But the 4-team, but there's only one more year of it, so it's moot. All right, let's go. Sorry. Thanks for letting me get another word edgewise,
you got it.
Corey.
You got it, man.
Good
you got
man.
It.
Good morning, Alzon and Corey. Random underscore John writes, I hope you both are feeling right as rain today. Is that a saying?
It is. Yeah.
I don't like rain. I don't like rain.
Yeah, right, I don't understand the saying, but it is a saying.
Well, that's when I was in Mississippi and it was raining and it was sunny out, and someone was like, "Huh, looks like the devil's being his wife again." I'm like,
"Yep, that's a Southern saying." My mom knows that one too. She introduced Stephanie to it a few months ago. Stephanie's like, "What?"
Yeah.
And so yeah.
All right, I have two questions. It's actually
it's cool that the devil got married.
Right? If the devil, you know I mean? There's hope for me. There's hope.
Exactly right, Aslan. If the devil can get married.
Shoot. And I won't beat you, women, I promise.
There you go, Aslan.
With May fast approaching, how are you both now feeling about Sam Spiegelman's December tweet about the elusive Destin Hill? Again, Sam Spiegelman, On3 recruiting reporter, very locked in to Louisiana recruiting, tweeted out in December that there's expectations that Destin Hill will enroll at Florida State in May, a source told him. How do we feel about that now? I haven't even thought about it until I just saw that.
Yep, yeah. I haven't either. And that's, you know, I guess that's not us really being in tune with the program we cover. But, yes, again, in May, if he shows up, that'll be something to talk about. But I don't have the slightest clue if that's happening, when it happens, and if it will make a hill of beans difference.
Yeah.
In 2023 or beyond, quite frankly, because they've upped the receiver room a little bit where Destin Hill doesn't come in and immediately you're wondering if he's going to get playing time. Here's a hint. He will not. So he maybe in 2024 he becomes something, but 2023 he won't make an impact even if he's here.
And yeah, the numbers they have, right? They're over 85, I think, if you the people that count scholarships that post the stuff on the board. So I don't know why they bring in a position that they don't need. But hey, if he shows up, cool. I just I think most people are like, sure, wake me up. I don't think there's a lot of people that are like dead focused on this. So I don't feel bad about maybe not being in tune with it. Question number two, it's a three-parter. So let me.
It's two, three, and four, though.
Yeah, let me put my glasses on for this. After Coach Hamilton pulled a Coach Bowden and built a program only to tear, it down, what do you feel is the best approach moving forward? There's a question mark after that. Keep the guy who tore everything down so badly that FSU had its worst season ever, or move on to someone else? Question mark. If they keep Ham, how many awful players? My gosh. These are not my words. I'm just reading them on my screen, everybody. If they keep Hamilton, how many awful players does he need to kick off the team to make room for those super sweet five-star transfers who want to play for a 75-year-old coach in his possible last season coaching? Question mark. What would that roster look like the year after for the new coach? Question mark. So that's actually four question marks, I think. So it was a four-parter. Feel free to do what you want with that one, Corey.
Really a five-parter if you count the Destin Hill start at the beginning, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, look, this isn't Bobby Bowden. Number one, his highs weren't nearly as high. Leonard never won a championship. And his lows were much lower than Bobby Bowden's ever were. So this isn't a Bobby Bowden a comparison, I don't think. Bobby Bowden was here for 35 years. He built the best program in the country. Leonard never had the best program in the country. He might have had the best team 1 year. But it's just not a comparison. And all, so the point being, they were probably, as we look back, a little too patient with old Bobby. Like, the writing was on the wall pretty quickly about an offensive coordinator he hired. But they let that go because he was Bobby Bowden. And they were still winning enough that, you know, they allowed it to mire in mediocrity and then get to, and then become just a bad program. And then finally there was enough is enough. And they ripped the Band-Aid off. 7-8 years after it started going downhill. That will not be the case with Florida State. You were talking about two bad years in a row. One that we can say it's an excuse or not, they got crushed by injuries. They are probably an NCAA tournament team last year if Polite and Osborne and some other guys didn't get hurt. Like Polite and Osborne specifically. Like, remember that team beat Duke. Duke made the Final Four. Florida State beat Duke last year and was like 5 or 6-2 in conference. Until the avalanche of injuries happened. They were not a great team. They had certainly taken a step back from the Scotty Barnes team and three step backs from the Trent Forrest team, but they were a fringe bubble tournament team. This team was awful. With or without injuries, this was going to be a bad basketball team. It turned into the worst in school history. That said, that's not enough with what Leonard Hamilton's done. Two bad years, one awful year, one injury-plagued year, isn't enough to say, in my opinion, see, old man. Thanks for what you did. We don't believe that you can have a good season next year because of the current landscape of the sport. Like we talked about, what was Miami 2 or 3 years ago, man? That I remember watching those Larinaga teams come into the Civic Center and just not compete. Like just give up 100 points. Like literally, Leonard beat them 9 times in a row. So that Miami team was not very good. They stuck with that guy. They hit the portal, and now look where they are. They're the number one seed in the tournament, in the ACC tournament. They're probably going to be a 4 or 5 in the NCAA tournament. They just made the Elite Eight. So it's not and he's old, too. He's as old as the hills. So it's not like it can't be done. The point being, but the overall point is this. If it looks anything like, and maybe it doesn't even matter if it looks anything like it. It might be his last year either way, or it might be if you don't have, you don't get to the tournaments your last year, certainly if you lose 20 games again, it's your last year. Like, you can't keep doing this forever. But I do think that he, in my opinion, has earned the right to try to get it right before he leaves. But there needs to be an exit strategy in place. This cannot go on in perpetuity where you're wondering every year if it's Leonard Hamilton's last year. I mean, Boeheim just stepped down. Williams and Kay have stepped down. Like, all these icons of the game, of the coaching fraternity, are stepping down. So Leonard knows that his time is short. He probably just doesn't want to go out with a 9-23 record. And that Alford, I think, will probably give him one more year to try to get it right. And yeah, you're right. Maybe he doesn't get a bunch of, I mean, I think, again, the school is more appealing. You get to play in the ACC for a program that has been good, that has a good fan base when they're good. And that could be appealing to a kid that's awesome at Towson. are as awesome at Nevada, he might want to come play in the ACC. So that can happen. Look, those Miami guys weren't incredible transfers. And look where they are. I mean, you know what I mean? They weren't like a kid transferring from Kentucky. And they ended up looking like this now. So, you know, it's not out of the realm of possibility to think that the basketball team can be good next year. It won't be great. Probably not going to win a title. But I do think Leonard deserves one more year to try to figure it out. But at that point, it is not Leonard Hamilton University. It's Florida State University. And if he can't figure it out, if it's still struggling, if they're losing money because nobody's going to the games because they're non-competitive, you make a change.
It's not really relevant what the roster would look like the year after for the new coach, right? Because whoever in this landscape, whoever is the new coach is going to purge and bring in all new sorts of guys, right?
So yep, correct.
Just touch on that one. All right, let's bundle these next two, and then we got two after that, and we'll be done.
Okay, all right, because I've got 17 minutes. I've got 17 minutes left on my battery charger.
Old dads and old wake up. When the team in Athens replaces their quarterback this year, those in competition have the luxury of knowing they will have a running game and time to throw. What a luxury. I realize we are light years ahead of where we were 3 years ago, but we struggled at times with above average defensive lines. My question is, how far out are we from going into a season with that same situation as the team up north? Cheers, old dad. My truth, wake up, Corey, getting ready to set sail for spring break. Enjoy.
I can't wait, man. I just, it's going to be something.
You guys have seen the guys up close. What's the over-under in games next year in where we control the line of scrimmage? So.
Nine?
You know, this is me being tongue-in-cheek in the open about, you know, a world where Florida State scores, you know, has 600 yards and no one gets touched. Just. Who doesn't struggle with above-average defensive lines but still manages a way to score 30 points, right? I mean, if you're a really good offense, you can struggle at times with above-average defensive lines and still score 30 points, which is pretty much where Florida State found themselves most situations other than the NC State game. You know, other than the 2013 team, which is a really cool thing to shoot for, and I guess we're looking at Alabama in this situation here, Corey, I do not think Florida State is some sort of inferior opponent that just magic dust and a really awesome schedule made them look great. It didn't hurt, but I don't know. Do you feel this sort of need, this an anxiety underlying in you, Corey, about what happens when this team starts playing really good teams with really good defensive lines?
No, I think that, you know, like you pointed out, they're going to, like Clemson, you know, they put up 28 points, probably should have been 35 points. And almost 500 yards of offense against that defense. But there were times when people got blown up and ruined plays and lost 6 yards or had to throw it away because your right tackle got beat or your guard got beat. Well, Clemson does that. Those are NFL guys. They're not. I watched a lot of Georgia football. That offense didn't click on all cylinders the whole season like it did against TCU. I think they scored one or two touchdowns against Kentucky. Like it wasn't. It wasn't like I would say that Florida State's offense was just as good as Georgia's, and I'll make a bold prediction and say that Florida State's offense in 2023 will be better than Georgia's. Now, that doesn't mean it's going to be a better football team because there's another side of the ball. But Florida State will have a very good offense. There will be some defensive lines that give the offense issues because that's what happens with football. There are some guys that are really hard to block. LSU has a linebacker that's impossible to block, apparently. So that's not going to be fun. But overall, I think Florida State's going to move the ball and score a lot of points on almost everyone. And I do think that Florida State is close. I don't know that they have – look, man, Georgia and those teams have top 10 picks on offensive line. There are you know, four picks, that four guys that will be drafted in the first two or three rounds. That's a NFL offensive line, like the 13 team did. I don't foresee Florida State having that this year, but – you know, they have guys that will play in the league. Multiple guys, in my opinion, that will find a roster spot in the NFL. That's an enormous step up from the days of recent year with this program. So yeah, I mean they're not gonna be Georgia's offensive line, but they're pretty darn good and they're deep. As long as they stay healthy, that's a deep offensive line that has a lot of versatility. And at least in my opinion, I don't know, man, two or three, four guys that will play on Sundays. And Byers, for all I know, Byers might be the best offensive lineman in the conference. We'll see, but he's really impressive physically.
Our guy Mark down in Naples. Way up. Who's been the most impressive newcomer at practice? What returning veteran do you think has taken the next step and looks to be most improved? FSU football is fun again. Go Noles.
It is fun again. Mark, absolutely, buddy. My battery's running low.
Oh,
ooh.
Impressive newcomer, Vandravius Jacobs.
Or my guy from Mississippi that I can never remember
Quindarius
his name.
Quindarius Jones.
I like both of them. And the reason that it's a wide receiver and a DB is because that's about all the commentary we can get through 2 days without pads. Again, Friday, it'll be much better to see the other guys that we – and I assume newcomers. We went with freshmen. It'll be much more fun and easy to see who's really standing out once pads come on. But, yeah, Vandravius Jacobs has been really impressive, just that speed, and he's caught most everything. He seems to be a hard worker, and he competes, which is all good to see.
And returning veteran, I mean, Julian Armella is not quite a veteran, but he looks like he's maybe done the best in the weight room. DJ Lundy's up there as well, but I don't know if I can say their play has been most improved because, again, it's been a little bit early without pads. Anybody returning-wise, Corey, thought that has – kind of maybe improved upon what you saw last year? AJ Duffy,
Not yet. AJ Duffy, but he's not really a veteran. But yes, he's been the best of. He's made to me a pretty big jump from last year to this year.
I hope we can answer like Thomas Schrader or Dennis Briggs or Derek McClendon.
Wouldn't that be something? Yeah,
like
that'd
one
be
of
cool.
those guys. That's you want to see him make that step. All right, last question. We love you, Mark. Sorry to gloss over it, but we got battery issues. Tennis ump, our guy Dave, Birmingham, wake up. Cannot wait for the season to begin. Do you believe that we will have a 1,000-yard rusher and a 1,000-yard receiver? Thank you. Drink the Luna. Support all the sponsors. Go Noles.
I do.
Yes.
I think Benson will get there, and I think Johnny Wilson will get there on the other at receiver. But, yeah, again, that's you saw how good this offense was last year, and it had neither. So it's not like a prerequisite to be great. To have a thousand yard rusher and a 1,000-yard receiver, it's more about the totality of the team and the stats. But yeah, I think both those guys will take another step. Again, that's their first year of really playing college football, and if they can both stay injury free, I foresee them both taking jumps and being even better than they were their first year. And so that should mean more production, more stats, more touchdowns, all the fun stuff.
Boom. Period. There we go. We made it, everybody. Stay connected to warchant.com. Jeff Cameron Show, 1 to 3 o'clock, Warchant TV, as well as 93.3 FM. And then 3:15, they'll be stretching. So we might have practice video up around 4 in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. And then check back 5:30-ish, 5:45. We'll have interviews after practice. And then maybe some footage of Jameis Winston throwing a pitch off the hill at Dick Howser Stadium as well. So it's going to be a busy
Hope they have a radar gun going. Yeah. And I'm telling you what, the way Jameis's NFL career is in peril, but in flux right now, maybe my man thinks maybe this is an audition.
Okay.
If he goes out there and throws 94 on his first pitch, maybe he gets into a spring training somewhere.
Well, Alex Anthropoulos, is he back? He's back, right? He's not with Atlanta anymore, though. But
Yeah. He's there.
All right.
They could always use bullpen help.
Yeah, there we go. He's Corey. I'm Aslan. Thank you for listening to Wake Up Warchant, presented by the Corner Pocket Bar and Grill. Don't forget, sign up for warchant.com. $10 for 4 months. Do it. Have a great weekend, everybody.